Next film stars Dudley Moore as an insanely jealous husband, and he's got reason to be concerned. That's because he's a symphony conductor married to the beautiful Nastasya Kinski, and through a series of mistaken assumptions, he believes that she is having an affair with Armand Desante, who is a violin soloist with Dudley Moore's orchestra. Now, to try and catch them in the act, Moore goes to Asante's apartment, not realizing that, yes, he is having an affair, but not with the woman Moore suspects. Now, one more thing to fully appreciate this scene. You have to know that Dudley Moore gave his wife a gold pumpkin-shaped pendant.
Oh. Oh. Are you okay?
What?
Are you all right?
Yeah.
Good. Shall we out? Huh?
Brittle.
It's a closet.
Yes, big one.
What brings you over?
What?
What brings you over here?
I wanted to talk to you about that, you know, bar 34 in the first movie.
The temple.
You want to broaden it? I think we should push straight through.
Let's do it. I'm taking a shower. I got the water running.
No, I don't hear the water.
It's a relatively quiet shower.
Right? Yeah, I'll be right back. You were my wife.
Now, later in the film, still believing that they're having an affair, Moore dreams up a wildly complicated scheme to kill his wife and frame Asante, but to do this, he needs a tape recording of Asante saying some suspicious words.
I wanted you to tell us the story about the two Armenian guys, the twins.
The Armenian twins?
Zelda and Mimi.
Well, to the best of my knowledge, I never met Armenian twins in my life.
Max! The Armenian twins.
No.
You told me about these two girls that you met, and they're Armenian girls. Armenian girls.
During the night I spent with the two Argentinian girls from the boarding school in Buenos Aires.
Right, right. Tell Daniela. Stella.
This will kill you.
See, that "this will kill you" line he's going to use later on. Now, toward the end of the film, when this movie finally gets down to the acting out of its murder plot, there is some genuinely funny slapstick involving Dudley Moore, who proves to be a most adept physical comedian. But to get to that point, it is a long, laborious, complicated wait. Unfaithfully Yours is a remake of an old-fashioned 30s screwball comedy, but one of the keys to those older films was that they had a terrific pace. They really moved along, and if the story was preposterous, who cared? There really wasn't time to think about it in those films of the 30s. Unfaithfully Yours, however, takes its own sweet times. Weren't those two clips kind of slow and deadly? It's not a bad movie, but we just have to wait so long for the funny stuff.
I think it is a bad movie, and I think it's so bad that when the so-called funny stuff comes, it's not that funny. And I call this an example of my old friend, the idiot plot.
Mm-hmm.
This plot depends upon the fact that Dudley Moore doesn't have one piece of information. Yeah. When he's talking to Armand Asante, and they're talking about, Asante says, well, of course I love her, so what if she's married?
Yeah.
And Dudley Moore thinks he's talking about his wife.
Right.
All Asante has to say is, no, not your wife, this other woman. One word, okay. During an hour and 15 minutes, at any point in that, one word and the movie would be over.
Okay.
And so you're sitting there totally frustrated.
But the only reason, I agree with you, but the only reason that you're doing it, because there are movies of the 30s that have the same idiot plot, you don't notice it. This thing needs to be speeded up. This done in fast motion with a Howard Hawks director instead of the guy who directed this, could have been a very funny picture, or
well,
as it was done, Preston Sturges.
Could have been a funny picture, but I'm just sitting there saying,
"All right,
how can he be so stupid?" You know, how
okay.
can well anyway?
How can the director be so stupid?
That's another good question.
Agreed on the Dudley Moore screwball comedy. It only works at the very end of the film.